Good morning. I'm Alan Cantor, a worship associate and member of this, the Unitarian Universalist Area Church at First Parish in Sherbourne. Our opening words this morning from Elizabeth Mount. From our very first breath, we reach out. Co-regulation, not self-regulation, is our nature. We find our cues from the sun and the moon, from each parent and caregiver. We find our place in this great turning planet by turning to one another. Generation to generation, we awaken to the dawn and fall asleep at the evening's end. Our life's journey is part of something greater, something simple, something divine. A flame cannot be lit without a spark. A life cannot begin without the air. And we cannot begin to find ourselves without love. May we reach out to one another. May we offer love and nurturing care. May we join together in celebration of the interdependence of our lives. In this spirit, let us worship together.
Good morning. I have several announcements to share with us this morning. The first is a series of announcements about the Good as New Shop, which takes place in our congregation in our church building every Wednesday and is reopening on October 6th. So, huge shout out to all of the people who have been working so hard on reopening GANS. It will officially reopen on October 13th, but October 6th it is open to churchgoers for a special pre-sale week. So come anytime between 10 and 4 on October 6th, and then any Wednesday from there on out, 10 to 4. The GANS donation spot is downstairs in Unity Hall. So GANS is now taking donations. Please do not leave them anywhere except Unity Hall. So only bring it when the church is open and bring it all the way downstairs. Don't leave it outside. You will make the church staff very happy if you follow these instructions. Finally, the shop received some foldable shelves from Dot Whitmire, and they are being sold for $25 and $30, and they're downstairs, so you can see Deb Barnett downstairs today in Alliance Hall if you are interested in those shelves. I have a number of announcements about coming back to church. First things first, let's all turn around and say wave hi to the camera and the folks at home. Hi, everybody. It's so good to be with you virtually in addition to in person. Look for signups in the weekly email. We're going to be bringing back the signups for chalice lighters, for flowers. So take a look in the weekly email and sign up to help us make worship happen every week. You also may notice that there are templates in your pews. Can people hold those up? Just show that you know what those are. So those are reusable, and they're going to be there every week. You may notice that they don't have the sermon titles or the hymn titles. They're sort of a generic template. That's because we are moving away from having paper orders of service, in part because of our new addition to the sanctuary, our screens, and in part because, well, there's a lot of reasons that we're moving away from them. And you're going to be noticing that this Sunday we're going to be using the screens for the first time. So you may see, or what you will see, in fact, is some videos. We're going to be able to bring people into the service who aren't actually able to be physically present with us. So we've got a music selection today. We are going to have the opening words on the slides, as well as the sermon titles, the song, the lyrics to the hymns, even though we're not going to be singing along with them. You can follow along on the slides. So please take a look at those. I also want to just give you a quick update on the seating in the sanctuary. So you will notice that on either side, every other pew is blocked off. And then in the center, all of the pews are open. So if you are interested in more social distancing in your seating, please take a seat on one of the sides. And if that is not something that you're needing at this time, you can sit in the center. If you are sitting on one of the side pews, please ask for consent before joining somebody else in the pew, just like we're asking for consent before hugging. We know that people have different levels of risk and that they're taking, and all of those are totally understandable, and we want to just be asking for consent from other people before we are interacting with them. I think that's what I have for COVID kind of back to church announcements. Other things are fairly similar to how they were before. We've got prayer cards and candles over here, and we'll be singing the kids out right after our Wonder Box. So that's what I've got this morning. Thank you so much. It's good to see you all. And, oh, yes, greet one another. It's not in our template. But, yes, anyway, please, as is our tradition, please stand and greet your neighbor.
As you can see, our opening words come to us from the poem A Cushion for Your Head by Hafiz. And if you'd please respond by saying, here at church. Just sit there right now. Don't do a thing. Just rest. Here at church. For your separation from God, from love, is the hardest work in this world. Here at church. Let me bring you trays of food and something that you like to drink. Here at church. You can use my soft words as a cushion for your head. Here at church. Please now stand in body or spirit for our hymn, Wake Now My Senses. And again, though it be awkward, please do just hum per our UUA guidelines. Thank you. Sarah's video today.
Wake now my senses and hear the earth call. Now my reason, reach out to the new.
Everybody, let's remain standing as Isaac Smith comes forward to light our chalice and we say together our covenant. Both are expressions of our life and our faith here in this community. And let us say together, love is the spirit of this church. And service is its law. This is our great covenant, to dwell together in peace, to seek truth in love, and to help one another. Everybody, please be seated. We got to say a special thank you to Sarah and to Valerie for singing today, because Sarah's not here. You guys are amazing. Thank you so much. I would love to invite anyone who is young, considers themselves young, who is young in spirit. I don't care. Just come on up if you want to. Don't come all at once. All right, we got one. While the kids are coming up, I know it's awkward. It's like super awkward to hum. I've been humming actually the whole time of my career, just by the way. But actually, the Unitarian Universalist Association has really strongly recommended that while we're trying to this sort of interim time to hum, and I get it. It's really awkward. So just, you know, we're all hanging with each other while we try to get through this. Okay. Good morning, you guys. Good morning, you guys. I have a wonder box. I need some help, though. Somebody want to come up and open? You had your hand up first, and plus you came up first. Yes. Remind me your names, because I haven't seen you so long. Eliza. Come on, Eliza. Ben? What we got inside, Eliza? We got sticks. Did you tell Reverend Heather she didn't clean up the box from last week? Okay. And then what else do you see in there? A rope. So hold up a stick for everybody, because we're kind of short. I know people all the way in the back. High, really high, hold it high. Okay, so Eliza, I want you to try to break it. You got it? Did you guys hear the snap? All right, put that back. Way to go, you just broke my message. Who else had their hand up? Here. Young man in a blue shirt. Remind me your name, because I need help remembering names. Brennan. Hi, Brennan. So try to break that for me, Brennan. You guys hear the snap?
Yeah.
Why are you applauding kids who are breaking stuff? My gosh. Okay. What do you notice about the things that we break? Are they like, what do you notice?
It gets sharper.
It gets what?
Sharper.
It gets sharper, that's true, yeah? They're sticks, and they're
made of
They're made of wood. Are they fragile? Are they hard to break, Eliza? Kind of. Okay, so next our test. So we know we can break one stick, right? Right?
Yeah.
Work with me, everybody, right? Okay, so now I need some more help. So I need somebody else. Do you want to come up? You want to come up and just get a bunch. Okay? Grab like a handful. Even a more of a handful. Even more of a handful. Yeah, yeah, yeah. All right. Now, hold them together. Yep, sorry. Gosh, we're making a mess today, aren't we? All right. Try to break all of those sticks. You're so strong. And I hear them crunching, but they're not quite. All right, let's see if anybody else can do it. Anybody else want to try? Remind me your name. Hi, June. All right. Try to break them. I know, right? There's like, if you break them, you actually wreck my whole meaning at this point. One more try. Let's see, young man, remind me your name. All right, Dylan. Now remember, the whole stake is, what's at stake here is my sermon, so. They're really hard to break, aren't they? Wait, okay, that's good. There's a crack in everything, but that's not the point. Then the last message. What do we have here? One piece of string. So, who would like to tie this into like a little shoelace for me? Who hasn't participated yet? All right. Can you tie that together for me? Yeah, it's like a weird string, yeah. Tie it tight. That's good. Keep tying. Awesome. All right. Heather, how am I doing? You guys know my point. Maybe, maybe not. Each of us are like one stick, right? And this whole last 18 months, we have been so alone. And we have been sort of a little bit easy to break, depending on the strength of our stick, which is sometimes our spirit. But when we're together, which is what we're able to do now, and those of you at home, we're together, we are a lot stronger. And the really cool thing about the word religion, which Jason's going to talk a little bit about later, and just about why we come here, is that the word religion. Listen, etymology, guys. Are you excited, etymology? The word religion means to tie together. That's what this means. So, you guys, this church right here is this waxy string. I mean, we lose some people along the way, but we can regather them. Here you go. Oh, you're going to clean up. Thank you. We are all together, and I'm so glad to be tied back together with all of us. All right, I made it through my first in-person Wonder Box. You have too, and you're amazing. Thank you so much for helping me. We're gonna, you're gonna go outside for faith formation this morning. Heather, any advice, instructions?
So everybody is going to go under the tent. Serena and Julia and Amanda and Larry and Kelly are going to be with you this morning. Everyone's going to start under the tent. Preschool through first grade is going to be on the playground. So if you have a preschooler through a first grader, you need to pick them up from the playground and sign them out. Everybody else will meet your families at the fellowship time outside. So go ahead and let's sing the kids out.
Go now in peace, go now in peace. Peace, go now in peace. May the Spirit.
Now is the time in our service where we find our center. Whether you're here in the sanctuary or at home, I invite you to place your feet on flat ground. Take a few deep breaths and give yourself these moments of quiet, of prayer, of stillness. We will now sing our call to prayer, "Wash Me Away." Please feel free to hum along. Many of us are carrying with us today prayers for loved ones, for the world we share, and prayers of joy and thanksgiving. We share the following prayers for loved ones. A prayer from Sarah Hickok for Jenny, whose daughter is being treated for mental health issues. Another prayer from Sarah for Melissa, recovering from breast cancer. A prayer from Alan Cantor for Patrick McCarthy, one of Reverend Becky's homeless people who has terminal brain cancer. A prayer from Dara for Zoe, who turned 20 this month. A prayer from Polina Sabinin that my mom finds her mental health and peace after being a victim of identity theft. Another prayer from Alan Cantor, for my brother Mitchell at home in hospice care, saying he wants a bit more time. And a prayer from Gary, for all my patients, for hope and courage over despair. For all of these prayers for loved ones and for those that remain unspoken, we light a candle. And we share prayers for the wider world, from Polina Sabinin, for everyone in the US, Russia, and the world, find their voices and power again in free and fair elections of their leaders. Too many voices have been silenced. A prayer from Dara, for Germany choosing a new leader. And for all of these prayers for our wider world, we light a second candle. And we also share prayers of gratitude and thanksgiving. We share prayers for this beautiful Sunday morning, for community that connects us, for friends near and far. For these prayers and those that remain unspoken, we light a final candle. And we pray together. Holy One, we arrive with so much longing for healing, for connection, for a moment of quiet. Let us connect here to our longing to that which we most need right here, right now. In this quiet moment, we pray for healing. We pray for connection. We pray for all of those people, including each of us, who carry hurts too tender to name, whose hearts sometimes feel so broken, whose eyes sometimes fill with tears. And Holy One, we pray that we might notice moments of joy, that we might find times of connection, of gratitude, of wholeness, and that those moments might sustain us when times feel too hard to bear. Holy One, we remember always that life holds both the wholeness and the brokenness, the joy and the pain. We know that there is no cure to being human but to love one another. May we be held in several moments of silence as we lift up our silent prayers.
Thank you. Go to the Woods by Mary Oliver. Ordinarily, I go to the woods alone, with not a single friend. For they are all smilers and talkers, and therefore unsuitable. I don't really want to be witness talking to the catbirds or hugging the old black oak tree. I have my way of praying, as you no doubt have yours. Besides, when I am alone, I can become invisible. I can sit on the top of a dune as motionless as an uprise of weeds until the foxes run by unconcerned. I can hear the almost unhearable sound of the roses singing. If you have ever gone to the woods with me, I must love you very much.
You saw with me, I'm sure, this week the footage, right, of on the border with the men on horseback with their reins whipping the Haitian immigrants crossing. You saw that with me? So we were trying to think in our staff meeting, it's just an intractable problem and so many complex and intersecting issues to reach out to, in particular, the Haitian immigrants and the country of Haiti. So years and years ago, we had the father of a young woman who was 19. Her name was Britt Gengel. And Britt died in the earthquake in Haiti in 2010. So he came and talked to us about this new organization that he had started, I think back in 2015 or so, called Be Like Britt. And the money that we gave then, helped to give then, has established this this school in Haiti for kids who don't have any families, so kids without a home. And so in response to the earthquake that has just happened, you know, several weeks ago, and even more kids now going back to Haiti that America sent back on planes, it's just like a heartbreaking story. Be Like Brit is responding once again and trying to provide educational resources. So today's offering, again, we give away every single week, share the offering, is going to be with Be Like Brit, and on the templates that you saw in your pews is the QR code, and you just hold up your camera phone to that, and it goes to our Realm database. If you don't want to do any of that, you just have cash. In the back, there is a bowl. Actually, Maria's standing up with it now. It'll be on the back table. You can just put it in there, too. So, friends, thank you very much for your generosity.
Together in this home. the name I'd learned to fear is welcome in this place. It helps me see the face of God to greet my outcasts here. We are here, here together in this home.
So glad everyone applauded. That's how I was feeling. That was lovely. Thank you. And so we are here, our second week in the building, both folks at home and here. And it's pretty exciting. I certainly have so much gratitude for being the next in line of what is, I'm sure, a long line of wonderful ministerial interns. We certainly know that's true of my predecessor. So here we are. This getting into ministry business is a second career for me. Some of you already know what my previous job was, but some of you may not. For the last 18 years, I was a blue man in the show Blue Man Group, right up to the pandemic. I was doing that show here in Boston. And I was going to preach a bit about it today, at least some of my experiences in Blue Man. I mean, more specifically, on how being a blue man led me to ministry. But something kept interrupting. Something presented itself and kept interrupting and interrupting until I finally had to pay attention. Church. Church is the culprit. Funny how church has a way of encouraging us in a different direction. But as for Blue Man, I'm sure I'm going to talk about it a lot over the next 2 years. Because the truth is that even if I'm not talking about it explicitly, I am implicitly, because it's such a huge part of who I was, who I am, and who I'm becoming. And this is certainly true of my theology as well. Performing as a blue man had a huge influence on my theology. And while at times it felt like a bit like whiplash, going from intro to Christian tradition or process theology to perform in the theater at night, the fact is that they each helped to clarify the other. But for now, I'll say that I do love talking about the show. And so if you're so inclined, please feel free to come and find me and and we can have a good chat about how long it takes to get that on and off. No. that's usually the first question. How long does it take to get that stuff? But now back to church. I have very strong feelings about church, but regardless of those feelings, I do think that church is radical. I think that it's countercultural what we're doing here today. And I can't shake the belief that church, this place, has been crucial in my life. That in fact, it saved my life. And that's not even hyperbolic to say. Because this isn't a new thing, my relationship to church. It started very young. I was raised Methodist in a very large Midwestern church. My strongest memories, besides swimming my way through the adults to the donut table during donut hour, were of Sunday school. I loved Sunday school. I mean, I loved it. I was not one easily plied with gold stars as a kid, but when it came to Sunday school, I couldn't acquire them fast enough. My favorite was Mrs. Hadley. She was my third grade school Sunday school teacher, and she didn't just hand out gold stars. She was handing out hugs. Huge, wrap you all up hugs were coming with those gold stars. And it was rare. It was rare that there wasn't a moment filled with joy when I was at Sunday school, except for when I narrowly lost out on playing the part of Jesus in the run-up to Palm Sunday. And I still think I would have done a better job. But when that Sunday came, there I was, waving my palm frond enthusiastically as Jesus passed me by. Because I felt loved there. And so the roots were laid that church was a place where people could be seen, loved, and encouraged. It would take me time to return to this idea, because I did eventually leave the church of my childhood. But in all my stops along the way, I've come to realize that it was this core experience that I was looking for, this experience of a love lived. So in today's reading, I think Mary Oliver captures this experience of love. This poem is pure magic to me. I love it. The first time I encountered it, it breezed past any potential defense right to the core. In those early days of this poem, I couldn't read it, I couldn't recite it without tearing up. That the kind of tearing up that you don't even realize it's happening until you're already in it. And so I think you could say that this poem moves me on a cellular level. But why? Why was it so moving? I got to thinking, why? Why the tears every time? So in it, the poet tells of their most sacred of places, what is of such high worth to them that they must go there and worship. So here we have an example of what Reverend Nathan was talking about last week when reminding us of the connections between worth and worship. But the poet tells us that they prefer to do this worshiping, this worthing, alone. And why being alone is so important. But then, after all that, after all this emphasizing of being alone for this worship, the poet tells that if you have been witness to, that if you've been a companion to, then let that tell you how much you are loved. And that's it. Right to the core. That even though this is the most private, most sacred parts of the poet, that they prefer to experience alone, they brought you. So I'm thinking about this. And the first thought that came to me was that I want to be one of those people. I want to be loved that way. I want someone to share the most sacred with me. But then I kept digging. And I came upon a truth, and this is the scary bit for me. It's because I realized this is how I want to love. I want those whom I love to know love this way, that I held nothing back, that they got it all. Because this to me, this is church. This is what I mean when I say church, because I think this is what's possible at church. And this is why I think church is so radical and countercultural, because for many of us, this is certainly true for me, this is hard and it's risky and it's painful to love this way. And it's no wonder people don't want to go to church. People are a mess, they're messy. And institutions, because they're full of people, are messy. And I'm thinking that holds true at least a little bit of here as well. But maybe not. This reminds me of something I heard early in my adult life, and has, of course, taken me the entirety of my adult life to ponder. And it's that Carl Jung said that consciousness comes at a price. Because I think that's what we're talking about here, consciousness. And while loving this way, consciously, can feel expensive, I believe the price is worth it. Because in my experience, the only way to your life is through the mess. This is church. So one of the things that drew me here to First Parish was hearing Reverend Nathan say that here is where we practice being who we say we want to be. The first time I heard this was Zoom church, and I thought, wow, I mean, that's a thing. What an aspiration. And what a challenge. But that's what I want. That's where I want to be. Because I think it's this practicing that leads us to the kind of love that Mary Oliver's talking about. And so we do it anyways, right? We come every single Sunday that we can anyways, because this is church. This is where we learn, by way of practice, that price, this risky love, the price of this risky love, it pales in comparison to the healing power that is sharing our most sacred selves with each other. The stakes are high, but the reward is great. And so I'm curious what you mean when you say church. I'm curious over the next week, weeks, months, and 2 years to learn about what it's like for you when you practice being who you say you want to be. What's it like? Does it feel risky? Does it feel easy? Painful? Joyful? And while I look forward to hearing you share these things with me, I also hope that you will, as I'm sure some of you already do, share them with each other. Because here again, we arrive at being seen, being loved, and being encouraged. Said another way, being in relationship. For it is in relationship that we are realized. Blessed be, and may it be so. Please stand, embody your spirit for our next hymn, Love Will Guide Us, and as we're doing, humming it.
Love will go.
this beautiful day, let us say our call to ministry. We go forth into the world in peace to act with works of love, to affirm each person's dignity, and to cherish the living earth. And so this is our call. And as you do this week, please think of this community and come back next week as you are. Amen.